announcements here. First is the ladies' night out. The next one is on the 13th at the Day Warehouse, and the sign-up is in the back. And also, Apple Butter Day is next Saturday for our famous grilled bologna booth, so please come out and get some homemade apple butter and come get a sandwich from us. And I had a sign-up sheet here with me, so if you are able to work, let me know, and I can add you to this. And we do, this is a drive-in sponsored event, so we have t-shirts for folks to wear as we're working in the community next Saturday. But please know, remember to wear a hat or a visor, since we are going to do this. Leslie Mason turned 16, I believe, last week. So if she's working the nursery today, so as you see her during passing the peace or something, or at her church, please wish her a happy birthday. And finally, youth group t-shirts, our new shirts are in, so see me in the back if you have not received your shirt that you ordered. Thank you.
Good morning.
My name's Lee with the men's group, and I'm taking a moment here to thank everybody that participated in the birthday potluck and the white elephant auction. We truly appreciate your response and your donations to that cause. Men did well. We had a great time and had a lot of laughs. And we sincerely thank you so much for your participation. Thank you.
Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so given his only son to die for us, and for his sake, forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our opening prayer. Like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading today is from Genesis 2. The Lord said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle, and to the birds of the air, and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib of the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bones of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read the Psalm 8 responsibly also. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You whose glory is chanted above the heavens out of the mouths of infants and children. You have set up a fortress against your enemies to silence the foe and avenger.
I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and stars, the seven horses. What are mere mortals that you should mind your plan? Human beings that you should prepare for them.
Yet you have made them little less than one. With glory and honor you crown them. You have made them rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
The second reading is from Hebrews 1. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we are speaking, to the angels. But someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet." Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Some very Moses' wife? He answered them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Jesus dying and his resurrection, and then we follow him. What else do you see up here that reminds you of Jesus? Anything? Nothing? What about the banners? We have these beautiful banners up here. We have one in the back. And then we have candles on the altar. We have flowers on the altar. We have cloths on the altar. Pastor has on special robes. We have the Christ candle over here. Do you remember the one over here that's lit all the time? Do you know why it's lit all the time? Do you know why it's there? No, well, it's called Christ candle, and it's lit to remind us that Christ is always with us. He's always there. That light never goes out. If you're here in the middle of the week, that light is on because Christ is always here. He's always with us. He's in our heart. The Holy Spirit takes care of us. But there's a couple other things I wanted to talk about, which was our bulletin. Some of you have them or are reading them now rather than listening, but that's okay. Some of you are using them as fans. I didn't think it was so warm in here, but you know, whatever. Anyways, you have this special bulletin. Well, the first thing, you know, a few weeks or months ago, a long time ago, I was in a rehab center, and I could not get to church, and I came down to the chapel. But chapel wasn't quite the same as coming here, and the very first Sunday that I was back, one of the things that I noticed that I missed was our organ music. We didn't get back to chapel, and it was like, hopefully it's after the announcements and everyone is here and gets to hear that those sounds and tunes that help us remember about Jesus. So I marked it in yellow in my bulletin. Then the very next thing we do is sing a hymn. If everyone gets to sing, and those hymns always tell a story. So if you ever get a kick, have mom do the word to you, and you'll sit up there and do some of the hymn. He's a little nose hanging, so.
Sorry, Nancy.
There you go. And then we go on, and the next thing we do is hear the Word of God is read to us by our reader. We have an Old Testament lesson, a New Testament lesson, and then Pastor reads the Gospel and reads to us out of the New Testament, and again we hear those words, and then we have the privilege of hearing his sermon. Sometimes it's short, sometimes it's very long, because he has a sermon, and he tells us about the Word of God. And then we respond with another hymn. We get to all enjoy and say those words of praise, and then we get to the very end, and there's another hymn. So over the next few weeks, we're going to talk some more about the bulletin and the impact that it has on us as Christians coming to church, to praise God and to pray and to worship God and to learn more about Him. So hopefully I'll see you next week. And hopefully Marvin's talking by then, so we'll have to see what he's doing. All right, thank you very much.
If God would withdraw the Word,
literally everything would cease to exist. It only exists. We only exist. The world only exists because God is changing every moment of every day. Somebody handed me a little flyer last week with a lot of fun things on it. I think it was Marguerite. But I love it. The last one was great. She said, take care of the planet. It's the only planet that has chocolate. I like that. We might sustain the chocolate, but God sustains everything else. He sustains this world. He sustains us. And really, when you think about it, that's an incredible statement about a humble carpenter from Nazareth, is it not? When Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, due to Caesar Augustus' tax enrollment policy and decree, he wasn't born into an affluent family. Jesus received no special educational opportunities other than afforded to all the Jewish boys in his community. Though my guess is that Mary and Joseph were conscientious parents. And yet Jesus grew up to change the entire relationship between God and humanity. As the writers of the New Testament look back on the effect Jesus had on everyone who met him, as they reflected on the nature of his crucifixion, his resurrection, ascension into heaven, they knew that this was no ordinary man. And the reason, by the way, why do we not have Jesus on the cross? It's called a crucifix. Well, some denominations, they put the emphasis on Jesus' crucifixion. That was important. We, as Lutherans, put the emphasis on the resurrection. So we have the cross. But Jesus is no longer on the cross. He's risen from the dead. By the way, why do we worship on Sunday? Why do we worship on Sunday instead of the Sabbath? First day of the week, Jesus rose from the dead on Sunday. So for us, every Sunday is a little Easter. We worship on the day that Jesus was resurrected from the dead. By the way, he rose on the Feast of First Fruits. And as Paul likes to share, he was the first fruits of the resurrection, literally, who rose from the dead on the feast of the first fruits, and reminding us that Jesus literally fulfilled all the promises that the scriptures unfolded about who the Messiah would be. He was and is the very Son of God. For in the words of the author of the book of Hebrews, he is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. Now that may be too much for us to digest and try to fathom or put our mind around that. But what he has done for us is just as important. What Jesus did for us is Jesus tasted death for us. But we see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, crowned with the glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, the honor, favor, and love of God, he might taste death for everyone. So the author writes in Hebrews. So here is the second attribute that we can say about Jesus. He tasted death for whom? For you. For us. All people of every time and every place, if they would simply, by faith, as a childlike faith, would simply say, hey, that's for me. I want a part of that. God says, yes, you shall have it. There's a little story that I like to tell you, across in some of this home about Jesus. It's about Dr. Nancy Wexler, who by the time she was 30, she was heading up the Commission for the Control of Huntington's Disease and its Consequences. And one of the commission's projects was to go down to Venezuela and to spend time around the villages around the lake of area of Maracaibo. Maracaibo, is that right? How do I say that? Maracaibo? There you go. Anyway, around those, because that is a hotbed for whatever raising up Huntington's disease. And there were certain families in there that they have Huntington's disease running as far back in it as anybody can remember. So what they want to do is take blood samples, skin samples of people, and then do this research. And at first it went pretty well. People were willing to give a little blood sample, a little tag of skin. And then after a while, the villagers, they said, no, we don't even know you people. You're taking our blood and our skin and you're leaving and with it. And we don't like that. And so it shut down. And they tried to explain it. They used every methodology they could. And nobody would buy it. Then there was a frustrated nurse. And she grabbed Ms. Wexler's arm, and she herself had given a little skin tab to be, she had a little scar where they took the little skin tab off her to do the biopsy. And she grabbed her arm and threw it in front of people and said, see, she has it, she has it, she's one of the family. She has the same mark that we're trying to give you. She gave her blood. And lo and behold, that was enough. And they started to give the blood and the skin samples again, and they were able to complete that kind of survey. The testimony of the New Testament is that Jesus Christ, who is the very reflection of the glory of God, emptied himself and became part of the human family. Look at the book of Philippians, fourth chapter. Not only that, he tasted death on our behalf. He who has at his disposal 12 legions of angels. Think of that. Jesus says to John, he says, don't you know that I have 12 legions of my Father's angels? Now, he didn't need those angels to protect himself, did he? And we remember in the book of Revelation, where the battle of Armageddon is getting ready to take place, if you read it closely, it never does happen. What happens is God sends one angel from heaven, mighty angel from heaven. He grabs the devil, the serpent, the dragon, and he casts him into the lake of fire. That's one angel does that. Jesus says, I have 12 legions. I don't know how many is a legion, a lot. 12 legions of angels at my disposal. And yet Jesus did not exercise his right to protect himself, but willingly gave himself over to arrest, to beating, to a mock trial before the Sanhedrin, and then again before Pilate. Then he was shamelessly beaten with the cat of nine tails and crucified. He tasted death on our behalf. God the Father turned away. Letting God for you, for your sake, for my sake. And sometimes we've heard that message so often, so frequently, we become desensitized to it. It doesn't have any effect on us anymore. But we need to hear it time and time again. We need to let that soak in, deep into our spirit and our soul, for what Jesus has done for us. The life changing radical implications for our lives. It is a claim so outrageous that it leaves no room for evasion. Either it is true or it is not. And here's the point, if it is true, then what does it say about us? What it says about us is that we matter. To whom? We matter to God. We matter to the Creator of the universe. We matter to God Almighty. Regardless of your gender, ethnicity, economic status, age, accomplishments, or lack thereof, Christ left his royal throne to give his life on behalf of us. Therefore, you matter. Here's how the author of Hebrews put it again. We are Christ's own brothers and sisters. Think of that. We are Christ's siblings. Absolutely, anyway. We have the same Father, spiritually speaking. And you understand what that means in an honor-shame culture. If you have the same Father, then you all share equally in the Father's honor status. It's not about your status of honor, my status of honor. It's about God Almighty's status of honor. He has the highest upon him. And his son has the highest of all of us because he is the firstborn. But we are still siblings of Jesus Christ. Co-heirs with Jesus of the kingdom of Almighty God. We've been bought with a price and brought into a new relationship with our Creator. In the words of our text, Jesus now calls us his brothers and sisters. The celebration of Holy Communion, beloved, is therefore a family celebration. You know, for 1500 years, from the time of Moses on, they celebrated and remembered the Passover, didn't they? Jesus brought an ancient flock festival, which was known to the people. They reinstituted into the Passover. Then Jesus, on the night which he was betrayed, took out two elements out of the Passover meal, reinstituted yet another meal of remembrance. But for 1500 years, the Jewish people rehearsed the coming of Messiah and rehearsed his death on Passover. Because that's literally what happened to Jesus. The lamb would be tied to the horns of the altar, the great 22-foot high altar in the court of the men, and he would be lashed. That little lamb would, the yearling male lamb, to the horns of the altar at 9 a.m. Jesus was crucified at 9 a.m. Then they would flail the lamb, stick the blood, slash it on the base of that altar all through the day. They would hang them on hooks and flay them out, take the meat home and celebrate Passover with that lamb, no bone broken, but everything folded in and roasted. They would eat that at night. And then at 3 o'clock, the evening sacrifice, that lamb who had been bound all day, was finally sacrificed on the great high altar. And Jesus died at 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Passover. He fulfilled that scripture literally, to the hour and to the minute, that they had rehearsed for 1,500 years. Well, the body of Christ has rehearsed the celebratory meal that will have with Jesus in eternity for over 2,000 years now. That's what we're doing Sunday by Sunday. We eat Jesus' body and the bread, and we receive in with and under the wine his true blood, and we sup on that as a rehearsal of the great feast we will all share in eternity with Jesus. As we sit at his table, where he says he will be the one to serve us. It's a great rehearsal each and every Sunday. And in that we remember who Jesus is and who we are. And the good news of our meeting, of being together as family. And we remember that Jesus tasted death for us and for our salvation. Then think then too of, again, who we are, his siblings, members of Jesus' own family. And he takes us like grain, reach up your little grain, and God takes you, and he forms you together in one loaf of bread as we eat and drink the sacrament. And then as you leave with a benediction, he breaks you, and he gives you for life the world. You know, when we pray the Lord's Prayer, we say, "Give us this day our daily bread." And we all pray it, don't we? Give us this day our daily bread. You know Luther's explanation? Not only food, but work, and all that kind of jazz. It's all daily bread. You ever think that somebody out there is praying, "Give me, Lord, today my daily bread"? And that daily bread might be you. You might be the answer to someone's prayer. God uses human beings to be his instruments of love and grace and mercy and compassion with all those with whom we live, to be a touch of God's grace as he breaks us and scatters us and sends us out back to our families, back to home, back to work, back to retirement, back to going to the grocery store, back to everything you do during the week. And God will use you as his gift of bread, gift of life, now sown into your flesh. Eaten him, and now we need you back. For those with whom we live and move and have our being. As one of his kids, out pioneering in the faith, in the midst of a dark and sinful and broken world, to be salt, to be light, to preserve the good, and to stand against the evil, to be a beacon of hope.
God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the people of God and Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Almighty and loving God, guide your people to experience true happiness as we seek to worship you more faithfully and walk more diligently in your ways. Lead us and guide us always in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant strength and courage to all in our country who protect us from harm, and grant them wisdom to perform their duties faithfully. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for the gift of marriage and of family. Renew, we pray, the commitment of husbands and wives to each other, that they might demonstrate true faithfulness and commitment in the face of the world, often rejecting your design for marriage as revealed to us in the Holy Scriptures. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the work of your church in building up the body of Christ, as you renew the spirits and faith of your people, we ask that your blessing be with our sister synod, Lutheran Congregations and Mission for Christ, as its annual gathering seeks to study your word, connect ministry partners from around the world, and rejoice with one another about the ministry they share. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those we name before you, and for all those known to you who are experiencing illness or sadness of any kind, that they come to know more fully your care for them. We look before your throne of grace, our homebound, our church family and friends in need of healing, strength, and comfort. Those named in our bulletin are our prayer chain, and those whom we now name aloud in the quiet of our own hearts. Lord, in your mercy, for those who mourn the death of friends and loved ones, may they live to meet certainty that those who die in the Lord will yet live with the Lord in eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
Father God, we have one more petition to save us for the families of those who grieve their children's loss as they were in school and were murdered. We give you thanks, Father, for the joy that was set before each one of those who died as they stood up, as we asked each one if they were a Christian or not, and when they said they were murdered. Father God, thank you for such faithfulness in these. Make us such faithful that we might go on and live our lives in a similar way, to be with all of their families as they grieve their loved one's death. Bind up their hearts, Father God. Hold them together. We remember them. We pray for your greatest mercy to be upon them. Now they look you in the eye face to face, and they're home with you, and we make our journey still. And so do their parents. So be with all of us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Lord, in your mercy. In your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share Christ's own peace. One
peace. Peace and happy birthday.
Hey, buddy.
God's peace. God's peace. God's peace.
Peace be with you.
Oh, all right.
Peace be with you. Yeah, and I think we grossed five something. So we still wound up with 470.
Better than spaghetti to lose in there.
Well, it tastes up long.
Hey, you guys.
Thank you. and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life, and so for the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you. Thank you.
Almighty God, you gave your Son both a sacrifice for sins and a model of a godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Thanks be to God.